here we've got something that some of the Broadlands are often very famous for. Right, so today you're joining us right in the centre of Broadland today. Chances are if you've ever been on a boat on holiday or down here on holiday, you'd either have hired the boat from here or certainly been through here. We're right in the centre of Wroxham village today. Little bit of break from the norm because we're not on a match fishing venue, we're actually on a venue that's just reserved for pleasure fishing. But I came down here at the weekend, my wife and daughter wanted to do a little bit of Christmas shopping, so they went off to Roy's of Wroxham and they did all of their Christmas shopping, had lunch, bought new outfits, all with change from a £20 note, or at least that's what they told me anyway. But I decided to give my ears a rest and come down here and have a couple of hours fishing on the riverfront here. So I literally just brought ready-made whip, my little Inception box, and a bucket of ground bait, and had a lovely couple of hours down here. So I thought I'd bring you guys and I'll show you what's what. So this is actually the River Bure. So it's quite a long river in the Broad system. It's 50 miles long, springs up in a little village called Melton Constable, and then comes through the village of Aylsham and snakes through the Norfolk countryside until you get through here to Wroxham, Horning, further downstream, and then it joins the River Ant and the River River Thurn before going out to sea at Great Yarmouth. But it's a lovely place to fish. It's probably, because it's one of the longest rivers, it's got the most number of broads joining it and boatyards joining it. So at various times a year, it's either full of fish or the fish go into the surrounding area. But this little bit, we're actually in November now, and this should get stronger and stronger through the winter here. Whereas a lot of the other Broadland rivers, the fishing will be a little bit more hit and miss through the day. So basically, come down here today just to show you how simple it can be, just for a quick pleasure session really. So I've got a couple of whips with me, already with the rigs on. The river itself isn't highly coloured like most of the Broadland rivers are. Normally you've got boat wash creating constant colour in the water, but here it's actually quite clear. You can see 18 inches down, whether it's the bottom of the river or the depth or something like that, that keeps it relatively clear most of the year. In fact, in the summer you get a bit of weed growth as a result of that, but now in November there's no problem with weed. It's quite silty on the bottom, and because of the clarity of the water, the lack of flow, there's only a very gentle flow on here and very gentle tide. I expect quite a lot of the fish to be off the bottom, so I've adjusted the ground bait mix accordingly. Normally I would use an amount of soil in my mix, feed little hard balls of ground bait with things like casters, that sort of thing, to try and get the fish grubbing around on the bottom to be able to run a bulk down rig over the top. But today we've put a little bit of Black Lake in the mix to try and create soft balls of ground bait. Although we're going to put two or three in to start off with to make a little bit of a bed on the bottom, they're going to go in quite soft to sort of lay on top of the silty nature of the riverbed, and then feed little soft nuggets that are going to break up before they hit the bottom after that, and maybe loose feed over the top as well. The only other thing I'm going to do is fish a little perch swim right against the boards here. It's not the best area for perch, that's sort of a little bit further down, but there's always a chance of a specimen perch here, so I wouldn't come down here and not do that today. So I'll just get a few bits and pieces prepared, and I'll talk you through the rigs and how I'm going to start to feed for the day. Okay, so we're just going to mix up the ground bait for the session. As always, I don't like to carry a drill on the bank and any excess bait, so I'm going to mix that up here in the car park before we go. It's a variation on my standard pole mix for all of these venues. The main ingredient is the So Natural Deep Water. It's a lot more versatile than the name would suggest. You can virtually use this for all situations. The only reason why I'm doing something slightly different today is because the water is very still and very clear, and I'm expecting to catch quite a lot of the fish off the bottom today. So although this is the main part of the ingredient, I'm actually going to add a little bit of Black Lake to it as well. The reason for that is Black Lake has got a little bit of coriander in it, which makes it a very active mix. So it should suit catching on the drop and catching off the bottom. It should suit that quite nicely. So the only other main ingredient I'm going to use is the So Natural Crushed Hemp. All I've done with that is poured boiling water on that the night before. If I was using it in a feeder mix, I'd probably use it straight out of the bag and keep it nice and active. But what pouring boiling water on it does, it changes the bait completely. So it brings out all the oils of the hemp, just like preparing a normal dry hemp seed for loose feed. But it also stops all the bits of shell from floating or anything like that. So this sort of porridge, if you like, is going to be the wet part of the ground bait. And then I'm going to add all the dry ingredients to that. The only other different thing that I do, if I was fishing a bit of the river that would flow, I would add soil to it, either molehill soil or just topsoil from the garden centre. The only thing you want to try and avoid is something that's very sandy. So if you've ever been to the garden centre and picked up a bag of topsoil, there's a hole in the corner. Probably been me, just checking what it's like. But because we're fishing off the bottom and we're going to feed it softer today, the soil's actually staying out of the mix. So what we're going to do, tip our porridge into the bucket first. Now that's just half a bag of So Natural Crushed Hemp, half a kettle full of water. So that gives us our wet ingredient. Then we're going to have a bag of deep water as the main part. And then just half a bag of the Black Lake to add a little bit of activity with all that coriander to the ground bait as well. So that's the mix for today. Just whisk that together, and that should make, although it's got quite a lot of body to it with the boiled crushed hemp, it should make quite a versatile soft mix that I can put two or three harder balls in to start the swim at the start of the session, and then feed little nuggets of soft ground bait over the top to try and lure the fish up in the water to catch on the drop. So you can see there, that wet hemp sludge is exactly the right amount of water for a bag and a half of ground bait. And that's mixed up to a damp consistency already. All the bread and bits of biscuit in that ground bait are going to soak that up quite quickly. And then we'll just whiz it through a riddle and we should have a lovely soft mix by the time we get on the bank. So I've just brought a couple of whips with me today, just to show how simple and quick the methods can be here. It's quite a nice little stretch here because it's always quite sheltered with the high tree line each side. So it'd be a nice area to come and fish a long pole, top and bottom float, waggler, even chucking a feeder out. But because it's nice and sheltered, we've not got too bad a wind. Just going to fish a whip today. So we've brought 4 or 5 metre response whips. I've set the 5 metre one up with a 1 gram bulk down rig. Now it's a little bit different to most of the rivers what I fish, because normally you'd have a little bit of flow to contend with, so you'd have an olivet and droppers. But I've done a bulk shot and quite a long way up the line and a string of droppers on this one. And then on the lighter rig, the 4 metre whip, I've set that up shallower with a strung out 0.7 rig. So I've still got a little block of shot for stability, and then even more strung out than what this one is. And as the session goes on, as we feed more, I'm expecting those fish to come up in the water because the water's quite clear with very little flow. And we'll alternate between the two depending on how the fish feed. So the beauty of a telescopic whip is you can bring them ready-made. You can have the rig permanently attached on the end if you want. Got a lovely soft flick tip. We'll run through how to attach the rigs to those in a little while. One thing to bear in mind whenever you're fishing a whip is not to overstretch yourself too much. If you've got any amount of flow or conditions deteriorate, never overstretch yourself and try and fish too far beyond the whip, because you always want your float to run through in a straight line parallel with the bank. Now today you've got very little flow, and very little wind. So we are going to go just beyond that and be able to fish around the bait a little bit more. But when you're plumbing up, you want to bear in mind, like on a stick float rod or something like that, you're always plumbing up at a bit of an angle. So the best thing to do is not plumb up on the whip at all. You want to plumb up on a short line rig if you've set one up. And I've set one of those up to fish for perch down the edge, and I'm going to use that with a couple of sections on just to plumb directly above the whip to get an accurate guesstimation of the depth, and then match the whip rigs up accordingly. Because if I were to put a plummet on this and swing it out, because of the angle, it'll seem like the water's deeper than what it actually is, so you'd be getting a false reading. So the only other rig that I've set up today, just on the top kit of my pole, is a bolt down rig just for perch, right in the margins against the pole bank. You've almost got the full depth of the river there, and you've always got a chance of a bonus perch there. But I'll use this rig for plumbing up. So plummet wise, with all river fishing, I'd use a big 30 gram plummet. Just pop that on, and you'll see here, even if I drop it against the bank, it's almost the full depth of the river straight away. So you can see there, that's quite a deep area. So just bring that up. And then if I put a couple of sections on to plumb out where I'm going to fish the whip, I can get a straight up and down reading with the plummet. So I haven't got any false readings. So I'll just lower that in, and I can feel that hit the bottom there. But if I let that go, like the float is sinking another couple of inches. So that tells me that that bottom there was quite silty. See there. So I've got to bear that in mind when I put the initial feed in for the ground bait, that there's a bit of silt on the bottom. So I want to make the ground bait softer and feed that accordingly. See there, that's just a tiny little bit deeper closer in where the boat's more against the bank. And then our perch swim is actually going to be right inside here, right against the bank. So you see there, that's about a float's length shallower there. Now, we're going to use ground bait on the whip line. Just going to feed that with, I've just put a few maggots and pinkies in the freezer last night just to kill them off. I've just got a pint of maggots, half a pint of pinkies, and just put a little handful in the freezer last night in a bag just to put in the initial feed, so I can feed a bigger quantity of bait on the initial feed, and a few of those will lay on top of the silt. And then as we go through the session, I'm going to introduce more live bait, both as loose feed and in the ground bait, to build the session up. And then the only other thing what we're going to do is feed a few chopped worms down the edge for the perch. Now, because of the depth, I don't really want to pop them in loose, so I'm going to use a bait dropper just to be able to feed them neat. That way I haven't got to put any ground bait down there, which isn't particularly perch friendly. So I'm just going to use a little bait dropper. So simple device, as soon as it hits the bottom, that opens up, tips the worms on the bottom. So because we're going to fish that to hand, it's a simple job of just putting that on my normal rig and shipping that out. But if we were, say, fishing a bait dropper on a long pole, that creates some problems, because if you dropped it, were to drop it in the edge, it would either open up, or a lot of the worm juice and things like that, a lot of the stuff what provides the attraction for the perch, is going to be washed away by the time you get to the swim. So the thing what we do for that is we'd actually use a cable tie on the pole. So you could put a cable tie around your pole section and just trim that off. But you could fill up your bait dropper, hook that over the top, and then you're free to ship the pole out to whatever length you want, turn it over, and then drop it straight down into your swim. But because we're fishing to hand today, we don't need to do any of that. We're just going to fish the bait dropper straight down below the pole tip. I'm going to put three droppers of that in for the perch, and then three balls of ground bait to start off the swim for the other species, and then feed little nuggets of ground bait and loose feed regularly over the top of that. So a couple of little things worth mentioning with any sort of whip fishing. One useful little product is the rig hookups. Because you've got a capped end on the whip, it's a useful little feature for storing the rig on the side of the whip. It also allows you to get the rig length exactly right. So when you see when I fish, I'll keep the whip in my hand at all times, crooked behind my fingers, so I've got these fingers free to hold the line, to bait up, to unhook the fish. So the whip never leaves my hand. And by doing it that way and getting the rig length exactly right, that rig hookup is ideal just for tucking your hook in when you swap between different rigs or anything like that. So nice little product for that. Then starting at the hook end, I've just got an N10 size 18 to 09. I like the N10s for most of this sort of style of fishing. If you needed a slightly heavier hook, we've got the N20s, that'll be what I'll use for perch down the side, but for all round fishing, the N10s are brilliant for this sort of thing, and I'll use anything between a 14 and a 22, depending on how the fish are coming. Then mainline-wise, I've got 013 power line on here. It's about the heaviest that I like to go on a whip, because it's more open to the elements than what you are on a short line pole rig. So as with any method of float fishing, the lighter the line, the easier it is to flick the float out, and the less it is disturbed by the wind, whether you're fishing a stick float, a waggler, or any sort of float. So especially for whip fishing, that's exaggerated a little bit. So I've got 013 on. Wouldn't like to go higher than that, but I still want the durability of moving shots about during the day and things like that. And float wise, it's worth mentioning, I've got the parallel float on there. It's a nice pattern for fishing a whip. Now normally a pencil float of this style will have the full length of the float as the pencil, but because here sometimes you get a lot of passing boats and things like that, that style of float rides in the ripple a little bit much, whereas this with a short little nickel titanium stem rides through the waves a little bit better than an all balsa float, which will be a bit more buoyant. The other thing worth bearing in mind, because we're catching a few fish off the bottom today, going to catch a few fish on the drop, you'll see a few of the bites are held up as the fish intercepts the bait before all the shots have sunk. And this little neck here allows us to spot that nicely. And a traditional pencil float will have quite a pronounced shoulder at that end, but this has got a nice little tapered neck with that anti-capillary paint on and a traditional side eye. So when the float goes in, it doesn't get hung up in the surface tension. So often a float will go in, it'll almost sit, and then you have to flick it to get it to dot down. That's the point that we want to be getting a bite today. So we don't want to be moving that float in the last foot of drop. So that little feature on the float is a very important thing. Today, hopefully, we'll be making the most of that. The only other float I've set up is a power for the perch down the edge, just because it's a more bulbous, thicker tip float. I set up a 125 gram power, little marker shot underneath, and then an Olivet and three droppers on that one. For fishing the whip, there's two different styles of casting. So normally for a bulk down rig, I'll either cast to the side or underarm. And then if I was fishing like on the 4 meter whip with a more strung out one, an overhead cast like a waggler straightens all those shots out, gets them to land in a nice straight line, and is completely tangle free. So by doing the two different methods today, you'll see both styles of casting and both methods of flicking the rig out. So just going to start on a maggot, see if we can catch straight away, and just keep building the peg up. Today, you can see, because it's such a sheltered section, we've got quite a nightmare with the leaves today, but we should be able to flick the rig in between it and not get too much trouble. So because you've got a bulk there to cast, just a simple case of flicking the rig out underarm and then holding it. So as the shots sink, you can see there I can slow that down just by tight lining down to the float, and that actually slows that down. So the slower you want the rig to settle, the more tightly you want to hold the rig in position. So you can see there, bite first chuck, oh, it's come off. Bite first cast, just as the rig settled. And that was a nice little perch there by the feels of it. So another maggot on. Nice little underarm flick with the bulk. A few maggots. That's a little trick for fishing the whip. You want to do all your feeding with your left hand. So if you're right-handed, hold the whip in your right hand so you don't have to put the rig down or anything like that. You can see there the float's just held up a little bit, so there's a bite. And another little perch on straight away. You can see there that last shot didn't settle, so it didn't take the float down to the bristle. And we've got a nice little perch to start the day. It's worth making a mental note in your head how long it takes for that float to fully cock and be dotted down to the bristle. And if there's any delay in that timing, then that's a fish intercepted the shots on the way down. So a few more maggots out, little nugget of ground bait. One thing to bear in mind whenever you're fishing the whip is to try and do all your feeding with your other hand, so you never have to put the whip down. That way you can keep control over your float, you can strike at any bites, and do all the feeding with the other hand, so the whip never has to leave your hand. Lovely roach here. So, beautiful pristine roach there. You can see, because the rip's crooked behind my fingers, I've not had to put the whip down to unhook. I've just got my fingers free to unhook the fish. And then the feeding is like an underhand flick. So, loose feed wise, just an underhand flick and the maggots go out in a nice group. If you threw them overhand, they'd spread out more. So you can keep them in quite a confined area. And then for feeding ground bait regular, it's almost like using three fingers to scoop a ball and to pack with your thumb. So two fingers, pack with a thumb. You've got a lovely soft ball of ground bait full of freebies there. And again, just the same underhand flick to flick that out into the swim. So what you're trying to do is you're not trying to do that beyond the float at all. What you want to do is try and do the ground bait just a little bit back from the float, maybe a foot, 18 inches back from the float. And then the loose feed to go from there to the float with nothing going past the float ideally. And that way you don't find yourself overstretching and the fish will come in towards you. Likewise, if the fish come up in the water, I can change to the shorter whip because you're fishing a shallower depth. You're in effect fishing a little bit further out because you've got more line above the float. So I'll show you that later on as the session progresses and the fish come up in the water more. So a few maggots again, little underarm flick, just this side of the float. Just keep watching that float. You're looking for the float not settling as well as your normal traditional under bites as well. Settled there, just caught on a leaf. And here, because we're anticipating most of the bites to be off the bottom, once that float has settled, it's almost like dead. So you would just leave it there for a couple of seconds, see if you get a bite. If not, out again, and just keep repeating the process so it's falling through the swim all the time. So you'll also notice there, because we've got a little bit of flow from right to left, all the feeding is being done slightly upstream of the float, but not upstream of me. So what you'll often get is the fish will come right up in the water to intercept the bait. And if you've done that upstream of yourself, you'll find it quite awkward to keep presentation of the rig, and you'll find it awkward to fish. Whereas if you feed just slightly below you and fish below that, you'll always be in control of your float. You'll always have the line behind the float to keep that presentation nice. So this river, being probably the longest in all the broadland areas, 50 miles long, there's a lot of broads that actually join this. You'll see opposite, you can see the mouth of Bridge Broad. That provides fishing all the way through the year. Obviously you need boat access to get into there, and then below the town, you've got the massive Wroxham Broad, numerous little boatyards and channels around all the holiday lets as well. And the fish tend to pack into here through the winter. So whereas a lot of the more open, exposed stretches of river become devoid of fish through the winter, or certainly throughout the day, this one provides some excellent winter sport. You've got numerous pike anglers have come past today. It's a very popular place for pike fishing through the winter. Just held up there. You see that float didn't quite fully cock. little perch. And yeah, it's quite a mecca for that sort of style of fishing. So because you've got the town centre there, it's quite a nice place just to come for the day. And you know, if you've got a lure rod or like we're doing today, just a whip and a pot of maggots, you can come down here for an hour or so. It's nice pile bank, it's nice and easy to sit on. You haven't got to wade out anywhere or do anything untoward. And then if you want to come down with the family, you've got all the shopping in the town centre as well. So you can see there, as the rig gets to full cock, just come out again and just keep repeating the process. And the more we feed, I think the more those fish are going to keep coming up in the water. And that is where the other rig will come into play. And we'll fish a much more strung out setup on that one to catch the fish as they intercept the bait on the way down. So we're just building the peg up nicely now. There's been a nice response from the fish already. As we feed more, the peg's getting stronger and stronger, but I've got a suspicion now that quite a few of the fish are coming up in the water. So I'm gonna swap from the bulk down 5 meter rig to the up in the water 4 meter rig. So basically with that, because the float is gonna be set quite a bit shallower, you've got a little bit more line above the float, so you're almost fishing exactly the same spot as with the 5 meter rig. And you'll see as well with the strung out rig, when I can get it out of my keep net, so with the 4 meter rig, because it's got a much more strung out shotting pattern on this one, because it's set shallower, you've got more line above the float. So you're almost fishing on top of where you were fishing with the 5 meter swim. So where those maggots were going in, just short of the float, I can fish that nicely with a shorter length of pole. But what we're gonna do with this, we're gonna change the cast. So instead of being able to flick it underarm, because we've not got the bulk to cast underarm, it's just going to be a simple overarm flick. So almost like you were chucking a waggler out. And that straightens all the shots out above the float, so you don't get in any tangles whatsoever. That rig in that way will never tangle. So whenever you're fishing a strung out rig, that little overarm flick just from the wrist, just to straighten the shots out, is always the best one. So there we go, fish straight away. And again, because the line is slightly shorter than the length of the whip, the lovely soft flick tip has taken all the cushion of the shot, but it's still under tension when I bring that fish to hand to unhook. Stick, even if you elasticated a whip, because we're catching a mixture of different sizes of fish today, that will affect where the fish comes to hand. So with a flick tip, whether the fish is an ounce or 6 ounces, they'll always come to the same point on your body, and you can bring them to hand to unhook nicely. So you don't have any dramas with reaching down or anything like that. So it really is a quick, effective way of catching a few fish. The only disadvantage that you get with it, obviously, is if you hook a fish that's too big for the whip to handle, and then you have to resort to elastic then. Or if you had wind conditions against you, or if bites were difficult to come by, then short lining on a pole with elastic is a far better option. But somewhere like this today, where the bites are quite quick and easy to get, you can do it nicely with a whip. You'll see here, because the float is slightly inside of where the other one was going, we're right in the middle of that feed, which suits the fish coming up in the water. With a 5 meter whip, we're fishing around and in the feed and searching for the fish. Whereas this, we've switched to this because the fish have come right into that better feed. So just had a little dace there. So another species on the list. So far we've had perch, rudd, roach and dace. So nice little mixture of species today. One thing is, as the fish get higher in the water, one thing to get in the habit of, and I didn't do it that time, is to throw the maggots out first before you flick the rig out. So I've had a little bite there, a few more maggots for the next cast. So just quickly bring that hand, unhook. So a few maggots out and then rig over the top. And that way, because they're sinking through the maggots, should increase the chances of a bite. Just keep that bait going in all the time. As soon as they come up in the water, you want to start to feed more and more regular. No indication there. So as soon as it's reached its full drop, out again, and just keep repeating the process. So as the fish come up in the water more, you want to decrease the amount that you feed, but double the regularity. So there's bait dropping through all the time. Stop that wind from holding that float up. Just so it goes through on a nice natural path. Keep bait going in all the time. You see there, just at that point, the wind just holds the float up, so the presentation becomes a little bit unnatural. So you just drop the whip to keep that going. And at that point, that's at full extent, so that's out again. And back in at the head of the swim. So we're just catching a little bit of an upstream wind today. So the up in the water rig is just catching the wind just a little bit, just hampering presentation very, very slightly. So I've just swapped back to the 5 meter rig just to give us a slightly longer run through and a little bit more line to get presentation with. And we just had a little lift straight away there. What you'll often find is when the fish are coming shallow like this, you'll just keep tinkering with the depth. So you'll almost get like a magic depth where every fish is hooked in the top lip nicely. You can unhook it quickly and it really speeds things up then, because every fish is coming to hand and you can unhook it very easily, just out of the top lip. But just keep tinkering around with the depths that you find in your bites and how you're putting the rig in. Oh, bonus fish. I guess I would say this is going to be a lovely rud. You can see here that soft tip on that flick tip. You'd often be scared of hooking fish of this size, but it handles it remarkably well. Obviously, the longer the whip, the more flexibility and the more give that you've got as well. And here we've got something that some of the broadlands are often very famous for, a really nice rud. Quite a rare fish these days on a lot of venues. But absolutely pristine condition. Beautiful bright red fins. That's a real treat today. So we've got a little bit of an upstream wind has just sprung up now, which is making the shorter whip a little bit awkward to fish to get a nice true run through with the float. So I've switched to this 5 meter rig and I'm almost using the slight upstream breeze to fill the line between the float and the pole tip, like almost like a sail of a ship, just to slow down the descent of the bait by using the slightly bigger float with a little bit more lead down. And the longer line, I can almost balance those to slow the descent of the rig to make it almost the same presentation as if I were still fishing the smaller strung out rig. So the rig goes out and then as the float is just starting to settle, just hold that line, just let that catch the breeze a little bit and that just slows that float down slows the descent of the float down, just makes a little bit longer to cock, gives the fish a little bit more time to see that bait descend. And I've switched to double maggot instead of single maggot, much more visible bait. And there we go, we're getting an indication straight away. Bump that one off. Oh, we've gone out with two maggots and we've come back with three, so at least it shows you we're feeding accurately. No wonder I bumped that one off. So flick the rig out. Don't forget, keep that feed going in all the time. Then you can see that line above the float has just come around in an arc like a sail of a boat. Just using that just to slow the descent of the rig. You can see it's taken longer to reach full cock, and the fish are taking that off the bottom. So we're almost achieving the same presentation as what we were with the little strung out rig. But because we've got a longer line and a little bit more lead to balance it against, we can do that now with the longer rig and get round the fact that there's a bit of an upstream wind. So there we go. You don't want it to slow the float completely, but just to slow it down as it's sinking. And then when it's sunk, we've got enough line to let the float just run through naturally there. And there we go, another fish straight away. So we fed those bait droppers a worm at the start. Just going to have a quick drop in. Hooked on a medium-sized dendrobina, straight through the head. Just nipped off the tail. Whenever you nip the tail off a worm, it doesn't seem to loop back over the hook point. So you don't get that annoying thing where you get a bite and hook a fish and it just bumps off where the worm's gone over the point of the hook. So just letting that rig cock, settle, and then just lowering in. Literally, we're like a foot out from the bank here. Looks like you wouldn't catch anything here, but this is a real holding feature for these perch, right against this pile bank. In fact, when you go further into the town stretch, it's probably going to become your main line. You know, there's that many perch there and of nice size that you'll catch the bulk of your fish there rather than fishing out in the channel for the roach and rudd like what we've done today. But here we go, just getting a really slow bite. Just leave it for a second. Here we go. Just got a single strand of number 8 original slip in there. Gives us enough scope if we do hook a perch, but because we're fishing to hand, we don't need a really soft elastic because we've not got any distance to ship the fish back. So beautiful perch, lovely colours in here. And we'll just have another drop straight in. So just put a slightly bigger worm on this time. Just test our luck. So you really have got a good depth right against these pilings here. If you've got moored boats or anything like that, it is a proper holding feature for these perch. They're regularly caught up to specimen size through this town and in Horning as well. And there we go, straight under. Leave it a second. And away we go. Just bring it out of the swim. Slightly bigger one. All of these clear waters seem to produce much nicer colour fish. The roach, the rudd, the perch that we've had have all been beautiful colours. It's even put fin up for us. So I'll just nip very head off, pass the hook in. Got an N20, size 14 on there to 012. You'd probably get away with a little bit heavier than that, but just to feel our way into the swim. Just drop the Olivette where you want the rig to land, let it all straighten up, and then just drop the last bit straight down maximising the time that the fish has to see the bait on the way down. See if we get another indication. If no bites are forthcoming, just lift it up the float's length again. Just let it straight down again. Normally with this method you get a really quick response, so you know, if you drop in first cast and you don't get one, chances are you're not going to get one. And then you can catch 2, 3, 4, maybe more in quick succession. And that's normally the bulk of what you're going to catch there. You can refeed it, but every time you refeed it, your chances diminish a little bit. So that's why I normally put a little bit more into start than I perhaps would for other species. And then just try and get that one hit from it. Let's bring that back and have one more drop in. And if this doesn't go, then we'll be back out for the roach and rudd. Got another nice little perch there just to end the session on. So been a fantastic day here at Wroxham today. A little bit different for me, you know, not being a match venue, but whether you're down here on holiday or just fancy a little pleasure session, especially late season like what we are now, this is ideal. I mean, it's free fishing and free parking, believe it or not. It's ideal if you want to send the missus off to the shops for a little while and come down here for a bit of peace and quiet. Yeah, we've had a real mixture of fish. We've had some lovely rudd, dace, roach, perch, real mixture, and they catch quite a few bream here as well. We've literally just fished a whip that we've brought ready-made, and half a pint of maggots, half a bag of ground bait. I think that's all we've got through today. So you can have a really simple day's fishing. I mean, we've brought all my kit today to do a bit of filming, but if you'd have turned up with a little seat box and a whip and a bucket with some ground bait in, that would have been plenty for today. So hopefully we've shown you how easy it is and how quick and simple it is just to go out and catch a few fish and have a lovely day's pleasure fishing. So, you know, another introduction to one of the Broads venues that are available to everybody. And fingers crossed you've enjoyed it, and if you like what you've seen, don't forget to like and subscribe.